Hi guys, this is Mark. We are at the point where we can start learning about Backendless Database APIs. There are quite a few of them available in Backendless, and my goal is to cover all, if possible, which I think it is. However, before we go into the actual lectures about the APIs, I wanted to take a moment to go over some basic foundational information that you should have in order to understand what APIs are, how they are structured, and that will make it easier for you to read our documentation because it can get rather technical, and we use same terms throughout to refer to headers and body and response structures and so on. So understanding what we are talking about and understanding how the APIs are structured will make it easier for you a number of tasks, such as debugging and understanding what went over the wire, how the request was structured, what you got in response, and so on. Even if you are developing without code, for instance, with using Codeless, understanding the structure of the APIs and what they are will only make you a better engineer. So here on my screen, I have a data table selected. It is called country with some sample data, as you can see on the screen. Let's run a basic API request. We will use REST console for this. And using that request as an example, we will go over the structure of the API because the structure is going to be exactly the same regardless what API it is. With that information, you will be empowered to see how APIs are structured for many other requests. So here, to make a very basic API request, I will switch to the REST console. And in here, simply by clicking the GET button, an API request is sent out. And this is the response that we got. So to see that actual API request, you can either just take the URL and then put it in the browser, and it's going to be exactly the same API request. In fact, I will do that right now. So I will copy the request URL and put it in the browser and just press enter. So right here in my browser, let me untap. There you go. So this is my browser. And as you can see, this is the URL that I copied, and this is the response that I got. So what happened here? Well, the browser actually executed an API request. And to see that request and to see how it is structured, I'm going to go into the dev tools. And for this, just right click and select inspect. I'm sure there is a shortcut for this, and select network. So whenever you select network, you will actually see the requests going over the network to the Backendless servers, and you will see the response as well. So here, if you just refresh this page, that request will happen. So here, the very first line where it says country, this is the API request. By clicking headers, this will give you some very important information about that request. So as you can see here, it has request URL and has request method. It is GET. So whenever you put any URL in the browser and just fetch that page, the browser will execute a GET request sent to the server. So with that information, let me switch to a slide where I will dissect an API request. And this way you will start understanding actual elements that that an API request is made of. API call structure. In any API call, there's going to be a request and then the corresponding response. So request will consist of at most four different parts. One of them, and it is present in any API request, it is going to be HTTP method. And you saw when I made that request in the browser, the method was GET. Other methods that are available are going to be PUT, POST, DELETE. There is also one that is not used as often, that is called patch. And another one could be options, which is something that the browser does by itself. We will not go in there yet. So for now, it is going to be important to remember that there are four core HTTP methods: GET, PUT, POST, and DELETE. And the semantics of these methods is that GET typically used to retrieve information from the server. POST and PUT are going to be used to either create a new record or modify a record or just do something on the server. And delete is used typically to delete a resource on the server. Endpoint, the second element right here, is going to be the actual URL, which identifies a unique resource that you want to perform an operation on. Or that resource could be just some kind of routine that you want to invoke to perform an operation. Like, for instance, when you're logging in, the endpoint will identify the resource that is responsible for performing the login for the user. Headers are optional and they have special format. And headers are used to provide additional context to the server about that request. So for instance, headers may indicate that you're sending data to the server in a JSON format, or headers may indicate that you're expecting a certain type of response. And this this may not mean a lot, especially if you're not a developer, and that is okay, but just understand that headers may be present there, and if they are required, then documentation will indicate that they are required, and the documentation will also describe what headers must be. The body is the actual data that you're sending to the server. In the example that I just ran, when I did that GET request, there was no body. Essentially, that request said, okay, I want to get data from that specific table. That's it. It had GET HTTP method, and it had an endpoint. The headers, while there were some headers, they were not really mandatory or needed in the most basic case. The response contains body, and then when I ran that request, you saw it, some JSON that came back with data records, objects that are stored in the database, and it also has some headers, and we will go back to see what they were. So this is essentially just the structure of the request and the response. No matter what the API request is, you will always have these four, at most four elements in the request. Some of them are optional, like headers may be optional and the body may be optional. It will vary from one API request to the next. Let's take a look at the actual request that we executed. So here, that was the request. We were running GET, the browser doing it for us. So when we put it in the browser tab, it's going to be a GET request. And then this was the URL that the request was sent to. So what do we have here? So number one, well, GET is the HTTP method. And then this long string is going to be the endpoint. So for instance, when you contact our support and we ask, well, what is the endpoint? Well, the endpoint is the actual URL where the request was sent to. The endpoint consists of elements of that endpoint that are also very important by itself. So what those elements are, here we have the domain name, and the domain name in our case will identify the actual backendless app that I'm communicating with, because every single app in Backendless has its own subdomain. And in this case, my app that I have, it is the servicevisitor.backendless.app. And that identifies the application that we're talking to. The API element of the endpoint indicates and tells the Backendless server that this is an API request. Because there may be other requests where we're just fetching files and they will designate that this is a request for file storage. So in here, we know it is an API request. Data designates that this is going to be an API request for the database, because in Backendless, we have identity management system where the users are stored, we have messaging system, we have push notifications, we have API services that are running in cloud code, and then slash data will identify and will tell Backendless that this is a database. And finally, the last element in the endpoint is country, and that is the table name. So here, by having all these elements in the endpoint, we have all the information to uniquely identify a specific table from where we want to get data from. And as you can see, it is all very compact, but also has all the information that is needed to execute that API request. Let's go back to Backendless console and continue our review there. So we're back in Backendless. Actually, this is not a console. This is a that browser tab that we opened. So let's take a closer look here at what exactly happened. So the request URL was, this is the endpoint GET request. Request headers, there were actually a bunch of headers, and those are the headers that the browser puts in there, and from the perspective of where we are right now, we can just skip them because they're not that important. Of course, there is some importance for them, but for what we're doing right now, they're completely irrelevant. We can just skip all those headers. Let's take a look at the response. Well, first of all, these are the response headers, okay? Some interesting things here to point out that, for instance, content type. This tells the client, in this case the browser is the client, that what you're getting back is going to be in the JSON format. So this content type header indicates in the response that the actual response is going to be in the JSON format. Also, server applied some compression. So this content encoding, gzip, means that the data that you're getting back is compressed, and the browser automatically decompressed it. But what this does is it allows to compress the data as it is going over the wire on the network to be smaller, so fewer bytes need to be sent back and forth. And then the actual response, this is going to be the complete response, and then if you click preview, this is just a better formatted response, and as you can see here, this is the data that we got back from the server. The same data is rendered right here in the browser. Okay. Now, in Backendless Console, it just makes things I'd say prettier, because here you can instantly see the response body. If you click grid, it will present that response in the grid format. But in here, it has all the same information. When you click get, you know it's going to be HTTP get going to this request URL. By the way, you can see full URL by just clicking this button, and that's going to be the full URL. So, and the same thing is going to be the case for all other requests, whether you're creating a new record or modifying a record or updating record or doing bulk inserts when you're adding multiple records with a single request, they all of them will fall into exactly the same structure of an API request. With this information, now we will go into the lectures about individual API requests, and every now and then we will pop into the dev tools and the network section just to see how those requests are structured, to give you a better view and knowledge and understanding of what actually happens when you use one or the other API in Backendless. I hope you found this video useful. Thank you for watching, and as always, happy coding.